Well, the news that S&A Foods in Derby had gone into administration this week came as a harsh blow for its 300 workers who now have to find new jobs. They'll be joining the 600 people made redundant when the Mark Group in Leicester collapsed 3 weeks ago. But behind the headlines, other figures show our economy is creating tens of thousands of jobs. So what are the prospects for those looking for work, and what's really going on in the jobs market? Our political editor Tony Rowe reports.
Bad news makes news, especially when it comes to jobs. 300 going at S&A Foods in Derby this week, devastating for each individual and their families. But what can be done for them?
The job market itself, there's a lot of zero-hours contracts, a lot of insecure work, a lot of low-paid work. And from what I understand from what we're hearing today is there are some employment opportunities, but not terribly many around the city.
Some of the most insecure employment over the last 5 years has been in the public sector.
Nothing demonstrates that more than the story of Centenary House in West Bridgford, built in 1989 for the county council as offices. And now it's demolished, a building site for new homes.
In Nottinghamshire alone, 80% of their office sites have gone. Throughout the East Midlands between 2010 and 2014, 75,000 public sector jobs have been shed. But it seems the private businesses are more than compensating, a rise of 122,000 jobs in the same period. A great example of that is Morgan Tucker, a consulting engineering company based in Newark. 10 years in business now, managing billions of pounds worth of construction projects all over the world during the worst recession of recent times. And all run by a man who used to work for a local authority.
We've grown the business phenomenally in the last 3 years. 3 years ago we employed probably about 25 people. At the end of this financial year we'll employ about 200 people. So we've grown five or sixfold in the last 3 years.
A new recruit for Morgan Tucker is Paul Barlow, and he's joined from Network Rail.
So previously I was working on extremely, extremely worthy projects and flagship projects, but here it's just so much faster and real, and it is risky, but you feel like there's more job satisfaction in that.
It's passed through so far with the Social Security.
So what about the hundreds out of work in Leicester and Derby in the past few weeks? With figures this week showing growth in the economy slowing to 0.5%, what hope is there?
S&A was reliable. We had a regular shift, regular time scale, what we were going to do. There's not around here. I don't see any of that kind of, such a company like that would give you that benefit of having a reliable job. It's just contracted work, 3 months, 4 months, that's it. And after that, there's no guarantee.
And that's the question. Is the economy strong enough to help?
So Heather, on the face of it, 120,000 jobs being created by the private sector sounds all well and good, but dig deeper and you see that some of those jobs have been reclassified from the public sector to the private sector. So people who work in sixth form colleges, for example, the Royal Mail, maybe it's not so good after all.
No, there's been a huge growth in private sector jobs. And as you saw from that piece, people feel liberated. And they allow themselves to be so much more productive than they were before because they can see the rewards are there for them to do that. And it's very interesting. I did a bit of digging around. In Derbyshire alone, there's 6,100 people out of work. On the two government websites that you use to find jobs, there's over 10,000 jobs in Derbyshire waiting for people to apply for.
So Heather's saying there's plenty of positives here, John, and there's little doubt that we are creating private sector jobs. In fact, the figures for the last financial year are pretty interesting. Almost 80,000 new private sector jobs and just 10,000 fewer public sector posts. So the private sector is clearly picking up the slack here.
Well, if you are on a 0 hours contract and you're called in for 5 hours during the week, that's classified as a job. And it is technically a job, but that doesn't compare with a full-time job on good pay. And on Wednesday, the government told the steel workers who are losing their jobs across the country to go get jobs in a sandwich factory. Well, I don't want a country where all the jobs are in sandwich factories. I want industry, I want permanent jobs, critically well-paid jobs. And the problem is 0 hour contracts, minimum wage, low pay. They're not jobs that are sustainable for people who want to have a family, have a home, and it's creating real problems out there, and the tax credits and the cuts in them are going to worsen it even more.
But as usual, John can only see the bad side of things. The truth is, if you come to South Derbyshire, you get Nestle. They've grown from 100 people to 1,000 people. They are on the living wage right now. You go along the road to Fachenda that deal with turkeys, they are on the living wage right now. There is growth there, there are proper jobs there.
But we know there are more apprentices being taken on.
75% of all the new jobs are full-time, proper jobs.
Well, we heard Amir Ali, who's now redundant in Derby in our film, saying it seems all to be to contract work, there's nothing permanent. Unite's David Jeffrey backed that up by saying there are plenty of low-paid jobs and plenty of zero-hours contracts out there, but that's not what people really want.
I know, but fortunately we've got lots and lots of students that zero-hour contracts are perfect for them. They can top up out of their studies with work time, and for people that just want to do a few hours, they are very, very important. But for people who want to have proper jobs that look after their family, I repeat again, there are over 10,000 proper jobs on the government website for these unemployed people to look for.
The viewers know the reality. Viewers know what's happening to their family and friends. And the reality is we are becoming a zero hours, low pay,
John,
low productivity economy. And we're falling behind China, falling behind Germany. And
it's
the prognosis
true,
for the country is desperate in the long term. We need industry, we need permanent jobs, we need full-time jobs, we need skills. What we're becoming is low skills, cheap.
Well, there is a skills gap, you can't deny that.
That's no good.
You're completely ignoring the latest report that's just come out. The automotive industry alone is the highest productivity in the world. And I'm really proud that Toyota and supply chain to Toyota in South Derbyshire are turning out fantastic cars, fantastic quality, and they are highly paid jobs. And they are looking for people.
And where's the steel coming from? It isn't going to be coming from Britain, because steel workers, steel production in Britain is about to end. Do we not need steel for cars, for railways, for skyscrapers, for other things? Yes, we do. We're handing the entire industry over to the Chinese. And what does the government say? Come on, China, take it all. You lot, go work in a sandwich factory. Or what are we going to do? Send sandwiches to China when they're sending steel here? You're wrecking the industrial base of this country.
Absolutely not true, John.
Future generations are going to pay a very, very heavy price. I don't think there's a great future in someone saying, age 16, go work in a sandwich factory and spend 40 years doing that.
We're going to have 3 million new apprenticeships. We've already had 2 million. You can be an apprentice accountant, you can be an apprentice lawyer, you can be an apprentice engineer, you can be an apprentice electrical engineer.
Most apprenticeships are apprentice fast food makers.
No,
that's
the reality.
We did see in our film that engineering company is creating jobs, but it's unlikely that workers from S&A who lost theirs this week are going to have the skills to fit into that market, and that's a problem. They're not going to find work easily now, are they? They don't have the skills that are needed.
They will, because part of the package, whenever a big company goes under, which is very, very tragic, I mean, the government has done enormous amounts to bringing corporation tax down from 28% to 20%, you know, cutting regulation left, right and centre. But there will be a package. It will involve retraining for people. It'll be about opportunities. I had one company that moved from South Derbyshire to Northern Ireland. Every single one of those people that left that firm within 4 weeks was re-employed. That is astonishing. And they were skilled guys who knew what to do.
There is some hope, John. You say there's no hope.
I had another one. It moved to Vietnam. And those people, what we're offering is cheap and tacky jobs, temporary jobs, zero-hour jobs.
Don't talk
that's
the country
the
down, John.
It's not talking the country.
Of course
that's
it
the
is.
That
it's
is
about
the reality.
Time you got off this.
It's a reality.
Really
how would you like your future to be based on zero-hour contracts, not knowing what's there, getting paid tiny amounts of money, as opposed to working in manufacturing, in steel, in great jobs?
And there are colleges in the East Midlands who are doing just that. We'll have to move on now. Next, the state of the NHS in the East Midlands. With winter approaching, pressure is likely to grow on already stretched services. The trusts which run our hospitals are all reporting they're heading for big deficits this year, with a funding gap across the region totalling almost £200 million. But what does this mean for patients? And how will our hospitals cope? Chris Doidge reports.
One of our hospitals was recently described as being in a financially precarious position. But could that outlook apply to any of our hospital trusts in the East Midlands? The Derby Teaching Hospital Trust is looking at a deficit of £29 million this year. For University Hospitals of Leicester, it's £34.1 million. United Lincolnshire Hospitals is predicting a £40.3 million deficit. The Sherwood Forest Hospital Trust is facing a £44.5 million shortfall. And for Nottingham University Hospitals Trust, it's £49.2 million. So is the picture as bleak as the numbers make it seem?
You have to see those numbers in the context of the overall size of the institution. So if we take as an example Nottingham University Hospitals NHS Trust, its last reported deficit was in the region of £50 million, but that's on a budget of nearly £900 million. So yes, it's a sizeable sum of money and the hospital has cost improvement programmes to try to address it. But when you see it in against the overall turnover, it's perhaps not so worrying.
One of the political parties set up to fight specifically about the NHS says the government's promise of extra cash isn't enough.
That £8 billion sounds like a lot of money, but it's not, because we've got a £100 billion budget, and that's over many years. And when you look at what the NHS is now having to afford, it's actually paying for more things.
But isn't £8 billion what the NHS itself asked for?
It's what the politically emplaced leaders of the NHS are asking for. A more realistic figure oscillates somewhere over at least £20 billion.
Whether it's an increasingly elderly population, growing use of agency staff, or paying off the PFI contracts from when they were built, when it comes to our hospital trust's finances, it never rains, it pours.
Well, we're joined now by Sue James, Chief Executive of the Derby Teaching Hospitals NHS Foundation Trust. Thanks for joining us, Sue. Your authority is facing a deficit of £29 million this year. How has that happened?
Well, there's a whole range of issues that are part of that. We've just done some detailed work with the regulator monitor to really understand that. About half of the costs relate to the PFI, which was put into place. It's in terms of the value for money for a PFI, and that's our new building.
It's paying off that.
But the assumptions that were made when it was put together were that costs that came from the government around supporting capital, for example, were at 6%. They're now at 3.5%, and the assumptions around interest rates were much higher then than they are now.
So what does this deficit mean for the running of the trust?
Well, at the moment, it means that we have to ask the government for additional cash, otherwise we would run out of cash. But in terms of delivering service, what it means is that we are continuing to deliver very high quality services. Mm. CQC reviewed our services earlier this year and gave us a good, which is quite unusual. We're delighted about that.
That is good, but how can patients not be affected when across the East Midlands we're talking about £200 million of deficit?
Patients are not being affected at the moment because extra cash is being found.
But will they be?
Well, what we need is time, because we need to be able to make sure that we are delivering as effective and efficient a service as we possibly can. Your clip talked about a £30 billion deficit, and that's absolutely right. We've asked for an additional £8 billion, and we're saying if we have that £8 billion, we can save an additional £22 billion.
Okay.
Now, the challenge is where we're going to get that money from, because demand is continuing to grow. For example, we've seen a 14% increase in the over 75s being admitted as emergencies.
Heather, where's the money going to come from? That's what Sue wants to know.
The money is going to come from Mr. Osborne, and it's very important that it does. Mr. Hunt, the Secretary of State for Health, has negotiated this. It's got to be done. Sir Simon Stevens, that put together this report, laid it out bare, and once you read that report page by page, it sings to you. It just has to be done.
So they're going to get the money then? You can reassure Sue on that.
Overall, absolutely it's going to be done, because it's the right thing to do. We were the only political party during the general election that said we would find the £8 billion, and we will find the £8
billion. But these trusts in the East Midlands, they are up to their eyes in debt. Leicester's hospitals had to get a £58 million government bailout earlier this year. Those loans then attract interest, and there's a cycle in this, isn't there, where it just keeps getting worse?
They do, and that's why it's incredibly important that overall the national deficit is kept down. The lower your national deficit, the lower the interest rate the government pays
stays on that 58 million that looks after that hospital and on the 20 million that looks after my best hospital.
Sue mentioned PFI, and that was a Labour thing, wasn't it? Labour brought that in, really.
Yeah, well, we copied John Major's introduction of PFI. I said at the time PFI wasn't the best way to finance new buildings, though it is accurate to say that if you had old buildings that hadn't been replaced, then the costs associated with them would also be very, very high.
Absolutely.
So actually, you know, it balances out. I wouldn't have done PFI. I'd have used standard government finance.
But as it is, we've got them, haven't we?
That's one of these, but it's not the only issue, because trusts that don't have PFI have also got equivalent debts. And really what the government needs to do is put more money in. Write off these debts is what I would do, is write them off, hold the chief execs and the boards to account on value for money and efficiency. I also think that should be continued.
Should the government write off these debts?
But there's got to be more money in. And as well, and as well into social care, which has been often missed. Local authorities and their money has been drastically cut. And that actually creates more costs for hospitals.
That's where you're going now, isn't it, Sue?
Yeah. That's a key issue for us. I mean, one of our big problems now is that we have large numbers of elderly patients with nowhere else to go. Mm. And they're coming into hospital when really they don't need to be in hospital.
Absolutely.
And then finding them a safe and an appropriate place to go home to is a real problem.
Should the government write off these debts?
I think they're going to have to. But I think that the issue for us going forward is how we actually provide services much more closely to patients' homes rather than everybody coming to hospital for treatment.
Can the government afford to write off these debts?
I would rather they didn't have to. But ultimately,
but Sue's saying you're going to have to.
Well, at the moment, what's happening is that we're bailing them out because it's the right thing to do. But it's the turnaround.
Well, isn't that a problem because there's not enough money's going in the first place?
No. What needs to change is the way hospitals and social care work together. That's why the NHS take rooms, beds at my local extra care unit, Oaklands in Swaddling Coats. That's where they get respite care. That's where people get really, really good care until they're well enough to go home. And the cost of that step down bed is so much different to the cost of actually being in hospital.
But this is a problem of money. There's not enough money coming in, is there?
No, in the first place.
There's three issues here. There's we have to deliver to our cost base, but we also have to deliver to our quality base. And after the scandal of mid-staffs, we have to make sure that we've got the right numbers of staff and that we deliver the right quality. And then crucially, the government has given us a range of access targets, things like how long patients wait for A&E, how long they wait for waiting list treatment. They are the best in the world, and the question has to be, can we afford those?
Yep.
But we really need a debate about whether we can afford those.
One of the issues here as well, Sue, is that Monitor, the regulating body, is saying that you aren't able to meet those waiting lists, and it will only get worse.
We are meeting our waiting lists, but we're meeting them at huge cost. We're paying doctors to work weekends. Mm-hmm. We're running our theatres 24/7 nearly. And in terms of A&E, the extra nurses and extra doctors we've put into A&E make our service fabulous, but it's much more than we can actually afford.
Okay, briefly, what's this winter going to be like for NHS patients?
Well, we've got a very clear winter plan, and I think, assuming everything goes well, and assuming we don't have a big flu epidemic, and assuming making all sorts of assumptions, we should be okay.
Sue James, thank you very much indeed for coming into the studio.